Fenulla, I am so excited to have you on my show. It has been so many years that we've worked together, we have known each other, we've met each other at various places, and you've become one of my dearest friends over the years. And I've waited for that perfect opportunity of when we can just really sit down and chat about this incredible journey that you've had. It's been an organic experience.
Yes, well, firstly, I just want to say I'm so excited to be with you in this setting and talking on your beautiful Open Chat show.
Thank you, my dear.
Incredible the work that you do, and you bless me. As a humble soul to humble soul, we share that energy and spirit. So,
absolutely, my darling.
It's truly an honor to be in this capacity with you. So thank you.
Yeah, absolutely, my love. So, talk to me about your journey. Dance, of course. Was one of those things that got you to experience, you know, parts of who you are.
Yeah, I mean, the way that I see it is really, especially now, it's just the dynamic manifest of consciousness. It expresses through that.
Yes.
And it expressed through dance. And I did then ballet, tap, jazz, Bharatanatyam, Bollywood, you know, explored in that area. And
it was the way. For many years.
Yeah, for so many years.
Yeah, yeah.
I loved singing. And I used to sing and dance. I had a whole show. My teddy bears were my audience. Like for so many years. And being South Asian, and in our society, it wasn't quite like the arts was then considered more of a hobby. You have to have a career.
Right.
And so, although that was my, you know, truest and dearest passion, I love storytelling, everything. Like, everything art-related was just where the expression would come from.
Yes.
And then I ended up, everyone was like, oh, you're so good with kids, you should be a teacher. I'm like, oh, okay, yeah. So I just kind of followed that, thinking that was the path I had to go. But which is great too, because I actually did enjoy just that whole experience, but I only taught 1 year. And then I was in a school, and I just realized at that point that, you know, I'm settling. Mm-hmm. This doesn't feel like where my expression's supposed to be.
Right.
I could do this and just be good with it and be fine with it, but there was something deeper. And my vocal coach said, you should go train, go to a school.
Yeah.
You never really just, you know, honored yourself to give this much of a time period into an institution where you're going to learn your dancing, your singing, your acting.
Right.
And
is that what took you to school?
Yeah, that's how I got to Randolph. My principal, get this, of all the principals I could have in my first year coming out of, you know, my education program, she was like, I had always wanted to pursue the arts, but I got married and had a child and I never did. And she said, I'll give you I'll grant you a leave of absence. Go do your program if you get a spot. So I auditioned, I got a spot, I had security, of course. Then my dad told my dad, you know, and he supported the school, but he wanted to make sure I had the security, because that's all our parents want, to make
of
sure
course.
you're going to be okay.
And that's why they don't want us to go into these fields, because they're not sure if we're going to be
okay.
Exactly. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, I get that about our parents that a lot of people, you know, harbor grudges about. You know?
No, I do understand that. And it's interesting, because when he was in the hospital in that last like few months, the minute I walked in and he, you know, made friends with the nurse, he was a very charming man, my dad.
Yes.
And be like, oh, that's my daughter, you know, the famous one, and she does this and she does writing. Did you bring your album with you? Do you have one in your purse? Can you give it to them? Oh, you know, and he would go on and on about all my achievements.
Wow.
And I was just like, I'm like, okay, dad. And it's funny, because it was like, you look at it and you're like, and you were more excited about me to pursue this, like, you know, so somewhat of a noble career that that our culture and society say, oh, that's a great career.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel things are a lot changing for, you know, especially for us South Asians in our North American culture. And people think it, you know, it's only from Bollywood or whatnot, but no, within our own culture here in North America, there more people are pursuing it.
I believe that in part is the reason why you, as the artist that you are, you know, you've never kind of put yourself in the box of I am a singer, or I am an actress, or I am a dancer, or I am, you know, an author. To you, you know, art is an expression that is limitless, right? And wherever, and one thing I've noticed with you is, you know, all of a sudden, out of the blue, you'll be doing a different facet, form of art.
It's so
right?
true.
And I want to talk about all these different forms. But before I do, I want to ask you, How does that happen with you? Like, how do you know that, you know, oh, I'm meant to do this now, or I'm meant to do this now? Like, do you have a plan? Is there a strategy? Like, where does this all come from for you?
It's somehow within you. It just comes, like, spontaneously, effortlessly.
Mm-hmm. So do you, like, wake up one day and decide that I'm going to...
I don't decide.
I don't know.
It just,
how does it
just expresses like,
take
okay,
us into your space.
Let's just go more about this, you know, with the recent films that I've done. I think that's a good way to give an example here.
Yes.
My hubby and I went to Hawaii and we were sitting there and just like really at that point, things were just surfacing where the, you know, the wisdom, the insights, everything was just being so illuminated in such profound ways. And the story of Nobody flashed.
Right.
Flashed.
Right.
Like, and I said to hubby, you know what we were talking about years ago? It's funny because I thought FenStar Productions was probably going to wind down.
Yeah.
Just the opposite was turning around at this point.
Wow.
Where I said, we better get Final Draft. It's a screenwriting software.
Yes.
I got to get the software when we get back. And
yes.
He goes, I do need to write it down. I'm like, no, I just trust. I've seen the whole thing. And I, you know, told him a little bit about it. And so as soon as I got home,
yeah.
I just allowed, literally,
Yeah.
And then that, and then as soon as it was done, he read it and he had tears in his eyes. Nobody's really about where someone is like, you know, like I was kind of like how I was telling you about myself and going about life. And but something is, there's an urge. There's something, she's like, something just doesn't seem like just okay. So when she's on her way to her engagement party, she spots a homeless person. Well, her mom makes mention. She looks and something changes. Her inner climate completely, something shifts.
Mm-hmm.
She's drawn to this woman.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't even know why.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it is. The spirit just calls you. You won't even know why.
Mm-hmm.
You're just pulled. And that's what happened, you know, to me, like just that pull within
right.
me.
Right. The interesting thing about you when you create.
Yes.
Yes. When you create in your spirit, you create in that place of physicality, right? Whether it was 30 dates, whether it was the book that you wrote, whether it's Nobody, I always feel that there's always an aspect of you and whatever it is that you are experiencing at that time that does come out in these different facets and forms of creativity.
Right. Well,
I mean, as humans we call it creativity, but you know, it's a form of the personal divine expression in a physiological space that others can also see. That's
right.
How I look at it.
Right. Yeah, I mean, a lot of my earlier works had a lot of my personal identity.
Yes.
But now it's not so much.
Well, I feel it's your spiritual identity
And not even like identity, because anything we're identified with names and forms, I really feel it's like consciousness expressing to consciousness about consciousness.
Right.
Simply.
Absolutely. What would you say, if you were to say, encapsulate it in one sentence, what would you say is the basic message of communication with Nobody?
Well, firstly, it says it's this, like, an urge comes within to seek true peace and happiness.
Yeah.
And when it's like this, when the seeker is ready, the guru appears.
So you're playing the seeker and the lady was the guru.
Yes.
What would be your advice? I'm not here to tell you to be someone or I'm putting you kind of in a spot here. Let's just say someone comes to you and says that, Fenulla, I know about your story. I know that you've been through certain things, certain inflictions that were there in your life, but look at you now. Like, I would never believe that any of that ever happened to you, right? What advice would you give to that person that wants to get where you are, right, but is where you were?
I would simply say is, if you really truly seek true peace and happiness, there's not really a lot you need to do. There's not 15 steps that all of these people have created. Step this, do that, pray to this, do to this. No, I would actually say sit in your being and just to your own, within your own Satguru, because each of us has our own Satguru, just say, whatever that inner prayer be, whether it be like, rid me of ego, merge me into you, let nothing remain, completely merge me, or it be like, don't give me the illusion that any of this belongs to me.
Right.
All is you.
Right.
And your heart, by the grace, will guide you, mm-hmm. whether it be to a book, mm-hmm. a person, mm-hmm. another group, mm-hmm. whatever it may be.
So am I right in assuming, just to encapsulate this,
okay.
that what you're saying here is whatever that something is that keeps you in your constant form of peace, whatever that is. So for you, it's, you know, meditating or yoga or it's silence.
Actually,
or whatever
yeah,
it may
yeah,
be,
yeah, yeah.
whatever it may okay. be, right? That is what people should recognize and will help them keep the constant space of tranquility within themselves.
Actually, I would say that just that simple urge to be in the heart space and come into that place of just that, it's more universal.
Whatever that may be for you.
Whatever it may be.
Yeah.
And you'll be guided.
Yeah.
I have full trust.
Yeah.
Because that, it's like it's like Rumi said this, the one who brought me here must take me home.
Mm, absolutely.
Knocking on the door, yeah. knocking to know I've been knocking from inside.
Yeah. So I know you say that you create just because it's something that just flows out of you.
Yeah.
But there's always something associated with why we do what we do. What is your something? You know, I want people to understand that before we end this interview. Like, what is that something?
I am that.
Mm-hmm.
There you go. The truest being is just the simplicity of being. Just.
You just are.
It's like Satchitananda, existence, bliss, consciousness. And
you,
then
you,
I don't.
You just are. You just are, girlfriend.
As we all are. And whatever dynamically will express out of me.
Let it be.
Then hallelujah. So let it be. I don't know.
Well, one thing I will definitely say, that with all the highs and lows and the ups and downs and everything that our human form goes through, you are one of the happiest people that I believe I know, and I know a lot of people. And honestly, it's been great sitting here chatting with you and kind of, you know, giving, you know, people a peek into how people who, you know, how people who aren't like most people feel we should be are. I love it. That note, I wish
yes.
you all the best
Aww.
In abundance with all that you are. I adore you, darling. Thank you so much for coming
and
chatting with us.
Thank you. I love you.